We're privileged to be of one accord. Trust that you came in that way, all tuned up. If not, you'll be able to do that in a brief period of time. Tonight we're going to be in John 3, the last three verses, verses 34 through 36. This will be our 40th exposition of this book. We, of course, these are more or less an overview, but we want to provide enough detail so you can work with it yourself. Now, to remind you that under the law of Moses, which were the words of the Old Covenant, the emphasis was placed on what men did, what they were to do. That's where the emphasis was. Remember the Ten Commandments, they weren't the covenant, they were the words of the covenant. The covenant was, we will do. That, God didn't have to say, I will do. See, but his I will do was conditioned upon what they did. So you read things in the law like, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, remember to keep. Honor thy father and mother. Thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. Thou shalt not. That's the Ten Commandments. It was all emphasized what they did or didn't do. The ceremonial law, which was the sacrificial system, the various ceremonies, cleansing ceremonies, birth ceremonies, those various ceremonies, the definitions, this is clean, this is unclean, the feast days, those all comprised what we call the ceremonial law. It was acting out the law. In other words, God dictated how they carried that out. They all concerned what the people were to do, all of them. This emphasis was underscored by conditions that were to be met by the people. The people were to meet the conditions. You read words like, if thou wilt, or if a man do, or if ye hearken diligently. And if you fulfill that, then the promise kicked in, but it all depended on what the people did. But now the new covenant emphasizes what God will do. And it's necessary to kind of go over this and over, to keep going over this, remember, because few people know this. Maybe some people know it intellectually, they know it, but it hasn't like dawned on their souls yet. So you read things like, I will make, I will put, I will write, I will be. They shall all know me. I will be merciful. Their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. And then he hath made the first soul. See, it's emphasized what God did. Now, there are commandments to be obeyed, to be sure, but they're not the basis for the new covenant. The new covenant is not founded upon commandments to be obeyed, but the commandments are to be obeyed. Make no mistake about it. The basis of the new covenant is founded upon faith. Faith is the only thing that can get a hold of what God's going to do. You doing what you were to do under the law had nothing whatsoever to do with faith. The law is not of faith. Whether you believe the law or not, had nothing whatsoever to do with it. It was doing was the thing, not believing. And Paul makes a distinct point of this in Galatians 3:12, that the law didn't require the people to believe. There's no commandment to believe under the law. They were condemned when they didn't believe, but there was no commandment to believe. Now, and our text reflects the nature of the new covenant. He whom God has sent, or he speaks the words of God, or God giveth not his spirit by measure unto him, or the Father loves the Son, or the Father has given things into his hand, or the wrath of God. See, the emphasis is on is on God. And it's reflected in this text that already, even though the new covenant wasn't not yet in effect, men were being prepared, prepared for it. This was what we might call the practical groundwork. People had to be taught how to think. The law didn't teach you how to think, how to reason, how to calculate, it didn't do that. So ministries of John the Baptist and Jesus were kind of reorienting people on how to think. In the final analysis, of course, the new covenant is based upon what Jesus did and does. Did his death, burial, and resurrection, does his intercession and mediation. See, so it's based on those things. If Jesus does his work, the new covenant's in force. If Jesus doesn't, it's not in force. God commissioned Jesus what to say when he went to earth, what to say and what to do. Jesus was not a freelancer, even though he was God manifest in the flesh. He did not do his will. He did his Father's will. So then what should we be doing? I mean, if he did his Father's will, if that's what he did, there should be no talk about what we should do. He represented God to man as a man. He lived out what God expects from men. In the final analysis, as I said, God dealing with man is based on what Jesus did and what he's doing. And what he did was commissioned. It was commissioned by God. God didn't say, now go down and do what you think is best. I mean, if you could say that to anyone, you would think God could say that to you. But he didn't. He didn't say, just do whatever you think is best. He told him what to do, told him what to say, told him when to do it. So John the Baptist was given to see the broad outline of these things. It's his words that we're reading here. He was given to see the broad outline of these things, which was quite amazing. Considering the dry period that preceded him in the 500-year vicinity, it's remarkable what he saw. Of course, he was filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. But his job was to point men Godward. That was his job. All right, here's our text. He's speaking now of the Lord Jesus. For he whom God has sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. The Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things into his hand. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Now you notice the certainty of these statements. These are not vague or conditional or ambiguous. See, they're very like a hammer blow, straightforward. He's speaking of Jesus. See, Jesus is so significant that once he mentions Jesus, he just says he, because he doesn't speak about Jesus, then speak about man, then speak about Jesus, then speak about the government, then speak about Jesus and speak about the family. He just speaks about Jesus. That's what he does. So he is still true until Jesus becomes a prominent person in your thinking. What he has done will not apply to you. Now that has some strong implications, because there's a whole lot of church people that Jesus is not the main person in their thinking or living or doing or speaking. But until he is, what he has done will not apply to you. God's not going to bless you through Jesus until you see who Jesus is and accept him in that capacity as God has revealed him. God has promised certain things will be experienced by us if we believe on his Son. Amen. If we do not, void. That's right. You've got no right to to tell anybody outside of Christ that God will take care of them. And that God cares for them. You've got no right, whether he does or not isn't the question. You've got no right to say that. And our text makes that pretty clear. This is why another Jesus, another gospel, another spirit, this is why it's so serious. If the Jesus is being preached is not the Jesus God has sent, talked about, then what has happened is the people are being alienated from God, because God can't work through a false Christ. Amen. And the real Christ cannot be proclaimed through a false gospel. Mm-hmm. And the Holy Spirit will not work in people if it's a different spirit. Mm-hmm. Now this is strong, what I'm going to say. But I'm becoming more and more convinced of this, that this is why the church is impotent. Until I say it's largely impotent, let me be more precise. This is why the church is largely impotent. It's because it has not embraced the Lord's Christ. Whatever Christ they believed in isn't the real Christ. Because the real Christ, God says what he'll do.
Amen.
Jesus said, if man hears my words and keeps them, and he tells you what he'll do, I'll manifest myself to him. My Father and I will move in, make our abode. He's already told us what he'd do. Mm-hmm. Working you to will and do of his own good pleasure, God said. He already told what he's going to do. So if that isn't happening, mm-hmm. then the real Jesus has not been embraced. Now, I don't know how.
Yeah.
I try and be as cautious as I can, mm-hmm. cautious as I can, but the Jesus most USA citizens, professing Christians, the Jesus that they have embraced is really an idol. And it's an idol like all idols. Here's what the psalmist said about idols. They have mouths, but they speak not. They have eyes. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses have they, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. Could it be that that's why things don't happen? I don't want to be hasty, mind you. I'm just saying, I can see how that could be the case. Either that or Jesus has changed his mode of operation and doesn't do in people what he said he'd do. He whom God has sent. See, God is the reason for Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus didn't come because of the condition of humanity. But that's not why he came. He came because God sent him. He did not come to solve a problem. He came to do God's will. Now you gotta doing God's will did involve solving a dilemma. But he came because God sent him, and he came to do God's will. And when he returned to heaven to do God's will. Not man's will. He didn't return to heaven and say, "Now, Father, I went down there and I see all these difficulties they have, and we got to help the people out." See, that's not the way it was.
Right.
He came down to earth so he'd be qualified as a man to work with this situation that humanity was in. Now, Jesus came to fulfill God's agenda, and he will not change that agenda. God doesn't change, and his agenda doesn't change. God, or Jesus, will allow you to be the centerpiece of his work. You may be tempted to want him to look at you as the main person in the world, but you are not the main person in the world, and God will not deal with you as though you were. You are one of a many. And we're all in the same boat. So our circumstances may differ, but we're all in the same boat. So he came because God sent him, not because of man's dilemma. And there's a vast difference between those views. One of the many summaries of man's role in redemption is this: we are his workmanship. created in Christ Jesus unto or in order to good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Now, who's the center of that? Who doesn't see who the center of that is? He did not make you superior to your problems. That, although in Christ you are, but that's not what drove the work. Your dilemma is not what drove the work. From God's viewpoint, it was humanity, not you. It was humanity. So when you're in Christ, that becomes personal. It's he loved me and gave himself for me. It becomes personal when you're in Christ. But until then, it's just general. That's all it is. Well, that perhaps isn't a good way to say it's all it is. What I mean, he doesn't go any further than that. In the Gospel of John, Jesus refers to the Father sending him 15 times. Father sent me 15 times. And 15 times he says, refers to God as him that sent me. Paul reminds us, God sent forth his Son. John does the same, 1 John 4:9. So it's wrong to think of Jesus outside of the fact that God sent him. And it seems simple, doesn't it? But now, if you put your ear to the ground, you'll hear people referring to Jesus coming into the world for other reasons than that. He wants the very best for you. Is that right? He doesn't want the very worst for you. I mean, I know that. But he wants God's name to be honored.
Amen. That's right.
He wants it to be honored in you.
Yes.
He came so you could be what God required you to be.
Yes.
See? And he was required what God required him to be. So it's wrong to think of Jesus outside or unrelated to God sending him. So he preaches Jesus can't be preached as, quote, a personal Savior, although he is. You know, there come a time in the 70s when things had been so generalized that all of a sudden, and people did not talk about this before the 70s. They didn't talk about a personal Savior, so that suddenly people saw that it was individualized, and so they began to talk about it, but they went overboard on it. They went overboard on it. See, God's plan is bigger than any one of us or any group of us.
That's right.
Is bigger. Bigger than any given generation.
That's right.
Or given period of time. Mm-hmm. It's bigger than that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he said, he whom God has sent speaks the word of God. That goes to if he sent a minute preacher. Preachers are sent. They're given to every man. Whoever God sent speaks God's words. This is fully realized in Christ. It is in measure realized in those who represent God whom God sends. He speaks the words of God. Some other version says he utters the words of God. He verbalizes them, we'd say. He says God's word, the sayings of God he speaks. He continues to speak God's word. He speaks God's message, which is what word means. It doesn't mean one word. It's a word. He delivers a word. It's a message. And he proclaims God's own message, the Amplified Bible says. Now, the idea here is that God delivered a message to men that was from God. It was a body of truth, of interrelated realities. In that message, there was a lot said about God. It's a lot said about Christ. A lot said about the human dilemma and the resolution to the human dilemma, but it was the overall message. Now, it might interest you to know that very few people that represent God have a message. They just kind of put their ear to the ground and see what the modern buzzwords is and what are and what's going on in the world, and that's what they preach about. But there's a message. The words of God don't just speak of random, unrelated words. It's a message, an overall integrated message, the words of God. It message defines the condition of men. The message does this. It defines all of sin and comes short of the glory. See, it defines the condition of man. It defines the appointment of God. Ultimately, it's the judgment. See, defines all of that. See, nothing in this world will make a person able to transition from mortality to immortality. There is no word of man that can make that happen. If they did, they'd put the funeral directors out of business. No word of man, no body of wisdom from man, no compilation of facts from man can make one pass from mortal to immortal. But the message of God can. Nothing from this world can do that. Satan is currently the god of this world. That's what he talks about. That's what he emphasizes, this world. That's what he emphasizes. But he's already been judged. The prince of this world is judged. Yes. See, that's what the word of God says. Yes. John 16:11. That is, he's doomed. There's no. He's going down, and everything he starts goes down, and everything that's with him goes down, and it all goes down. Yeah. He's already been judged. There's going to be no additional judgment for Satan. He's already been rejected, totally rejected. So anything that comes from him is rejected. Amen. That's why you got to know. You got to try the spirits. You have to know where this thing come from. If it came from Satan, it may sound really good, but it's going down. Amen. It can't last. And if it came from God, it can't go down. Yeah. That's the way it is. Now he speaks. He speaks the words of God for or because. God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. Other versions say without measure is not by measure. Gives the Spirit generously. That's a bad translation. Because generously is a measure. Does not give the Spirit in limited degree. That's not too good itself either. Without limit, all right, he does not ration. I don't like that either. Does not give the Spirit sparingly. See, sparingly, it's a measure. He doesn't give by measure. Without reserve and so forth. Without measure does mean without limit or boundaries. There's no maximum. There's no extent to which the power doesn't, there's no area in which Jesus' power doesn't reach.
Yeah, amen.
There's no area in which the Holy Spirit is not a thorough enabler.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
With Jesus, he gives not the Spirit by measure unto him. In other words, in him all fullness,
yes, amen,
dwells. Colossians 1:9. See, that's what that's talking about.
Yeah.
It's wrong to try and get something Jesus gives from somebody else.
Amen.
This is not right.
Uh-huh.
Now, Jesus is a wonderful counselor.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah 9:6. The Holy Spirit, he's a counselor.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, how right is it to seek counsel from somebody else? You say, well, we all got it. No, none of that we all stuff. Just cut that out. Is the Holy Spirit a counselor? Is Jesus a counselor or not?
Yes.
Has God provided in salvation a thorough counselor or not?
Yes. Amen.
Yeah. If he has, then that's where you should seek counsel first. He may send you to someone else. I know that he may they like Cornelius and say, call for Peter.
Uh-huh.
But he was counseled. Cornelius was counseled to do that.
That's right. Yes.
And he did. On a practical basis, that means that by divine intention, nothing can be received from God that does not come through Jesus or that Jesus does not dispense.
Mm-hmm.
So if you got something legitimately from God, you got it through Jesus.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, if you're not reconciled to Jesus, or you're not fellowshipping with Jesus, you don't get anything from him.
Mm-hmm.
You got to walk with Christ. Live for Christ, to have these lines open for communication.
Yes.
Some people are deficient just because they walk under the distance. That's why they're deficient.
Yes.
That's why they have trouble after trouble after trouble. It derails them. That's why. They're at a distance. God giveth not the spirit by measure unto him.
Yeah, Brother Gibbon, I'm of the persuasion that a lot of people don't go to Jesus because they don't know that he can actually communicate with them.
Yeah.
I mean, they just think it's in a book and it's like a story, yeah. But it doesn't really have a real person.
Yeah, they haven't heard the gospel.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, they heard it and rejected it. Uh-huh. That is possible too. It means Jesus is... See, if a person is not connected with Jesus, Jesus is not interceding for them. He's interceding for those that come to God through him. See, that's Hebrews 7:25. So Jesus isn't working on behalf of people that aren't interested in him. See, well, that doesn't sound too good. Well, it's not too good.
That's right,
but that's the arrangement. That's the arrangement. God has given everything into Christ's hands, and you got to be somehow associated with Jesus to get it.
Amen.
That's fair enough. I mean, there's nothing unfair about that.
Right.
Spiritual blessings are all in Christ. He's given us all spiritual blessings in Christ. See, that's where they are. You can't come to God without all things pertaining to life and godliness. They're in Christ. The love of God is... in Christ. Who can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus? See, that's where it is.
Yes.
God will not supply all our needs. He'll supply our need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:19. The peace of God is from Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:7. So to seek something or receive something, anything apart from God, apart from Jesus Christ, is a totally vain pursuit.
Yeah.
Now, Satan may deceive someone into thinking they really got something, but it won't do what needs to be done. The fullness of the Godhead dwells in him bodily. That's another way of saying spirit without measure.
Yeah.
All right, so the spirit, he explains to us why Jesus is the centerpiece. He's taken all the resources men need, and he's given them to Christ. He doesn't give them to directly to anybody.
Amen.
He gives them to Christ.
That's right.
Christ dispenses them, and he does it through the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Now he said the Father loves the Son. Now the preeminent question isn't does God love humanity?
Yeah. That's right.
Although we know that. When we were yet, he loved us before. We don't understand. But the preeminent question is not whether God loves humanity. That's not the preeminent question. Because we have to do with Jesus, the preeminent question is, does God love Jesus? That is the preeminent question, because that's who we got to get everything from. So I want to know, does God love him or not? Okay, well, of course. No, it's no of course. This is declared in Scripture. This is not a deduction. This is a revelation.
Amen. Yeah. That's a prayer.
We're not to deduce that God loves Christ. It's a proclamation that God loves Christ. And there's a big difference.
Uh-huh.
He doesn't leave that up to men to conclude that.
Yes.
He declares that.
Yeah. Well, there's no other way for us to know that.
That's exactly right.
Uh-huh.
The Father loves the Son. Now, God referred to Jesus as my beloved Son. That's just very much loved, very much. My beloved Son. Jesus said, my Father, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. See, he doesn't say God loves me because I'm going to save the world. God loves me because I'm doing what he said for me to do. I'm going to lay down my life, take it up again. Again, he says that the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. See, because Jesus, he continued his entire tenure in the world. He continued in God's love. He didn't frustrate that love. He didn't go against that love. He didn't violate it. Jesus says, disciples, you've got to do the same thing.
Yeah.
Just like I stayed in the Father's love, you've got to abide in my love. Don't you be walking out there somewhere that of which Jesus doesn't approve. Don't tempt the Lord your God.
Amen.
This needs to be told people.
Yeah.
You may shout loud and long that the Lord Jesus loves you, but don't tempt him by wandering into areas he forbids. Uh-huh. Don't do it, young or old. Uh-huh. Now, it's really time for the church to start insisting on this.
Yeah.
We can't read people's minds, but we can sure exhort them and admonish them.
Tried to tell Jesus what to do. Lord, this shall never happen.
That's right, there you are.
He sharply rebuked
him. That's right.
That's what we should do too. Satan will try the same tactic with us in our measure. Yes, but Jason.
Yeah, I think we have. Anytime we just are discussing this thing about God's love or the love of Christ or anything, I think we have to, first of all, we have to just repudiate the popular definition of love. Like, that's not even what we're talking about.
Yeah, that's
right.
True.
That's part of the problem, I think, in all these discussions is you have to define your terms. In any discussion, you have to define your terms. And I just flat out don't accept the cultural definition of love that is then applied to the love of God.
Amen.
That's not...
Amen.
We don't define love that way. God is love. Mm-hmm. And the scriptures define love, and the gospel tells us what love means.
Amen.
So that whole discussion about love, I think, is it's really done a disservice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it's imposing a definition of love that's not a godly definition in the first place.
That's why I said herein is
that's
love.
Right. Yeah.
Hmm? Yes.
Kind of like in discussion about faith. When you get in a conversation with someone who defines faith by a worldly kind of definition, they're thinking of it in terms of an idea or purely as a belief or a thought.
Mm-hmm.
Can't really engage the person on that level
Amen.
At all to get
Amen.
Anywhere with teaching about
That's right.
mm-hmm. what it means to trust God in a dynamic way. That's what you got to talk about.
Yeah. I can see what you and Brother Jason just brought up. I can see Satan's strategy here. Satan tries to change the definition of key words. Like church is another one. He tries to change the definition, because if he can change the definition, people will miss the point.
That's right.
You will not surely die.
You will not surely die. That's right. Amen.
Not only that, but it can be a great distraction if you get caught in continually trying to address the falsehood instead of defining the truth.
That's right.
And cause people to say, this is what I'm talking about. I'm not even talking about this that you've already said, that you've defined.
Yeah.
I can't have a conversation about that because this is what I'm talking
yes.
about.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah, the falseness of these are found by comparison.
Right. Yes.
A false view of love contradicts a revealed view of love. So that's why you proclaim what God, how God has defined it.
People talk on how God is love, because even you brought this point out, since there is a different definition, just saying God loves you, well, that person, if they have a different idea of love, that has a completely different meaning to it.
Right.
If you just leave it at that. So you can't just assume people know what you mean when you say
that's
things
right.
like that, or even faith. Like, you need to have faith in God. Well, what does that mean to somebody?
Uh-huh.
Right.
So, I mean, it's a good exhortation to be precise.
Amen.
Yeah.
Now, the Word of God is precise on these things, but it has to be declared. People can't assume that everybody is reading the Bible and knows what the Word of God says about this. You can't assume that.
That's right.
The prophet said of Jesus, "This is mine elect in whom my soul delighteth." All right. See, that helps you to understand. That text is referred to as beloved in Ephesians 1:6. It says beloved. So, in whom he delights. All right. See, that helps to define what love is. Now, we must first draw attention to the use of the word son. The Father loves the Son. This does not refer to the pre-incarnate Word. When he was with God and was God, even though at that time he was loved. Mm-hmm. Thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. See, so even though that is true, that's not what he's talking about here. Mm-hmm. He's not talking about God's view of the Word before he became flesh. Mm-hmm. He's talking about after that.
Amen.
I will be, again, it is written, when he brought his first begotten into the world, he said, let all the angels of God worship him. And again, another place it says, he said, this day have I begotten thee. It isn't that God didn't love the Word. He said in this, when he humbled himself and came into the world, he loved him in that capacity. Which, if Jesus was going to carry out the will of God, this had to, as a man, this had to be true. He couldn't carry out the will of God if God wasn't like attracted to him, delighted in him, preferred him. He couldn't. He couldn't do it.
Yeah.
He was then humbled.
Mm-hmm.
So this affirmation is declaring God particularly loved the Son in his redemptive role. And this makes sense because we're required to love him in that capacity.
Yeah.
I'm afraid that Satan has introduced like an anonymous view of Christ.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not really connected with a person. It's just a certain anonymity to it all. It's not a clear definition. But here, when it says the Father loves the sons, that's all right. That's very, very definitive. And now this has a lot to do how God's going to regard your attitude toward His Son, whom He loves. So now this has a lot to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yet the Father loves the Son, and you don't.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know how you'd prove that God was attracted to you. It's your view of Christ that constrains God to accept you.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Brother, this concept of Jesus being the Son is something that had even been communicated to the Jews down through the centuries. The critical nature of this.
Yeah.
Because this is why they determined that had blasphemed God.
That's right. This was the point.
They took up stones to stone him. Why? Because you claim to be God's son.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He was convicted to
death.
That was a critical
thing.
For death, like in Caiaphas's court. This was the point he was convicted of.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a specific and unique expression of God's love. It's important because this is the kind of love now that's comes with salvation. This is the thing that guarantees salvation.
Yeah.
If salvation was guaranteed on the basis of your love for God, all right, it might have ebbs and flows.
Mm-hmm.
But it's determined by God's love for His Son, see.
Amen.
It relates to God's eternal purpose, which He purposed in Christ Jesus before the world began. This purpose would be carried out and implemented by the man, Christ Jesus. And so we'll have some confidence. It's affirmed that God loves the man Christ Jesus, who is His Son, who He begat.
Yeah.
The Word wasn't begotten.
That's right.
Everybody can see that, I'm sure. The Word wasn't begotten, it always was, but the Son was begotten. And His love is focused particularly on the Son because everything really centers in Him. It doesn't center in you. It doesn't center in the church. It centers in Christ.
Yeah.
So that's why this is of such critical importance. You will never find an occasion where God is in any way displeased with Jesus. You will not discover this.
Yeah, that's right.
Every time you come to God in the name of Christ and your heart's in it, the door's wide open. He loves the Son. This is why you've got to maintain fellowship with Christ. So you're called into the fellowship of Christ. Why? Because He's the one God loves. If you're not in fellowship with Christ, you can't benefit from Christ's beneficence and goodness and mercy and grace and all the other attributes that are needed to be saved. It's all in Christ. So your attitude toward Christ determines whether the door is open or locked. Well, I'll tell you this. A living God demands a living association.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a living association with His Son. He demands that we have a living, active association with Christ. It cannot just be by intellectual consent.
Yeah, that's right.
It won't work.
Amen.
Salvation is not designed to even work in that context.
Mm-hmm.
See, Jesus Himself is the truth. That I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, He loves the Son. and he's given everything into his hand. All things means precisely that, all things. This not only includes all flesh, John 17, 2 says you give him power over all flesh. He's over all men. So if someone's your enemy, Christ is over that person. If someone has something from God you need, Jesus is over that person too, see? He's not only as all flesh, but all angels and authorities and powers. He's over them too. He's the head of the church. See, all things be given into sin. He's the head of the church, and he can dispense at his will whatever he requires. It's been put into his hand. He has, let's look at his repository. He has unsearchable riches. And they're distributed to whomever he wills. He has power over those. All judgment been given to him, John 5:22. No valid assessments are made apart from him. That's what all judgment is given to him. So there's no valid assessment that Jesus hasn't made. He sends angels, they're made subject to him, and he sends them forth at his will, who minister to his people. He may send an angel to Cornelius. He may send an angel to Paul. But he has charge. All things been given into his hand. God says to him, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is a scepter of thy kingdom. God loves Jesus because everything he does is right. Everything is in perfect sync with the will of God. If Jesus does it, it perfectly reflects what God wants. Now, Jesus knows the Father's given all things into his hand. He knew, even in the flesh, he knew that. John 13:3, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, he's approaching his death. He knew this. It's important that you know it. I can tell you, when you forget this, you'll be troubled about certain certain things will trouble you when you forget this. And when you're being troubled and you kind of sense you should be unduly troubled about it, you got to get back to this truth and ask God to help you to get a hold of it. All things have been put in his hand. Trouble or no trouble. Employer or no employer, government or no government, Russia bombs or not Russia bombs, tornadoes or not. Everything's been put in his hand. So you got to get back to thinking that way. He said, all things are delivered to me of my Father. Matthew 11:27. So there's no needed resource Jesus cannot dispense. And if we were to tonight give everyone an opportunity to testify, everybody here, if they're honest, there's something you need before God. There's something you need. All right. Now my job and anyone else's job is to tell you Jesus can dispense that. What you need, Jesus has power over that. He can dispense it. There's no enemy Jesus can't subdue. Whatever comes from God now comes through Christ. It's his assessment that's honored in heaven, not ours. Amen. See, our will's got to come into under harmony with his. Why should Jesus ever be neglected, or forgotten, or ignored, or disobeyed? Who can support logic like that? All this is going on all the time. This is going on. What excuse can be given for not maintaining fellowship with Christ? How will anybody be able to explain sliding backward? Why do professing Christians seek counsel and strength from men? Why do they do it? Do they think God like looks over this? When he's made this arrangement, then he's told us he's made this arrangement, and Jesus has confirmed he made the arrangement, and the apostles gave a double affirmation, then how's God going to view this? Is it any wonder that men, insightful men, flee to Christ to lay hold on the refuge, flee to him for refuge to lay hold on the hope set before them? Do you wonder why people do that? It's because they've seen this. They've seen it. What about the weary and heavy laden? They come to Jesus. Why do they come to Jesus? They see, they've seen this that we're talking about. To some measure, they've seen it. You'll find that this will, you'll never feel like you've seen the whole of this. That all things are in His hand. You'll sense that there's a lot about this I haven't seen yet. But instead of saying, well, nobody can see it, press in to see it. There have been some members of the human race that have seen a whole lot more of this than other people have. And this tells me that there's a big open door here that everybody can take advantage of. Because all authority and power have been given to Him, no one who's reconciled to God, no one who's a new creation in Christ has to live in spiritual squalor.
Yeah.
Now there's a lot of people living in spiritual squalor. Paupers, they're spiritual paupers. If you viewed their life, you wouldn't have any idea that everything's been given to Christ's hand, to Christ's hand. You'd have no idea that that's true. So then, I would admonish and suggest you to live in such a manner as people will at least get this idea that you've got access to something they don't have. So maybe you got trouble, but it's how you react to the trouble.
Yes.
That's your testimony. Some people are surprised. They'll be surprised if you tell them you have trouble, because they never concluded that by watching you. They thought you were living on top of a mountain and never had any trouble at all. When you tell them, well, they had no idea. That's a witness. That's your light shining, see? And the reason it can shine is because Jesus really, everything really has been placed in His hand.
About the riches of His grace and riches of His glory. That term riches is another term needs to be defined biblically, not according to this world. We
know
that countless preachers
who
define it the same way the world does.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. Like the law, it's how the law defined it, remember? Do, cattle, land, health.
Yeah.
That's how they define it. That's all they could have. But a better day has been brought in now.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah, I think this is, you could harmonize this, all things into His hands, with what it says in the opening chapter of Hebrews. He's the heir.
Yeah, heir of all things.
Now, originally a son was an heir.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Particularly the firstborn. The firstborn son is the heir of the
father.
All things are going to be given to that firstborn heir. This is the idea here. Mm-hmm. He's the son. He's not inferior.
No.
But He's the heir. He's the one that Father's going to give. And particularly this involves the new creation.
That's right.
The world to come.
Amen.
Now, Jesus does rule this world too, but particularly the all things that He's going to, we're going to inherit, see,
Amen.
What He has. We're co-heirs with Christ.
Right. Amen.
And that primarily involves the world to come.
See, mm-hmm. That's what differs from earthly heirship. He shares His inheritance with His brothers. The world would think, like a brother, everybody gets an equal portion. But that's not how it's distributed. Then he continues, He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. You would notice all through here these solid affirmations that are made. He whom God has sent speaketh the words of God. See how positive that is? God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. The Father loves the Son, given all things into his hand. He that believes on the Son has everlasting life. You see, that's just sledgehammer statements. Uh-huh. Not could be's, may be, ought to be. It's not that. Mm-hmm. He that believes on the Son. Other versions say believes in the Son. New King James Version. As used here, believe on emphasizes Jesus as a foundation. Mm-hmm. On.
Yeah.
The word in would accentuate Jesus as a residence. Mm. See, or environment. And Jesus is both. He's both. He's both the foundation and He's a house.
Yeah.
He's both of them.
Yeah.
The word in, by definition, comes from a Greek word ice that is a hotly debated in some circles, but it means entrance into, of a place entered or an entrance into a place, It stands before nouns designated an open place, a hollow thing, or one in which an object can be hidden. It denotes relationship and by extension toward a goal. See, so it is where the person enters. That is the point. He that believes on the Son is not talking about an intellectual exercise. Yes.
I think part of that too is believing. It's seeing his relationship to the Father.
That's right.
It's Jesus as the Son, relative to the Father. That's different. See, believing on the Son in this way is different than like what people talk about the historical Jesus.
Oh, amen.
So there are a lot of people that say, well, yeah, I believe there was an historical Jesus.
Yeah.
But that's not believing on the Son.
No.
Because that doesn't have anything to do with his relationship to God.
Yeah, why I mentioned this into, and some versions do read that way, into, is that it's in Christ that this truth opens up to you. Believing on the Son has to do with totally relying. And this is always done from the inside.
Yeah.
Totally relying on Him and being in the Son. Mm-hmm. Speaks of a condition where the human spirit and Jesus spirit are integrated.
Yeah, that's right.
1 Corinthians 6:17 says, he that's joined, it's into, see, joined to the Lord is one spirit. Believing, then, is not a mere profession, as Brother Jason as well pointed out. It's not the adoption of a creed. Here's what we believe. But it's not that sort of thing. Or the embrace of an intellectual position. What do you believe about, XX? It includes a lively consciousness of Christ. We know him, but has said, see. We are in him. Believing on the Son of God is what compelled Paul to write this. Now, this is a breakdown of believing on the Son. I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. He found me. I want to be found of him, not having my own righteousness, but the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain to the resurrection of the dead. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now notice, he wasn't believing that Jesus was identified with him, although he was. His faith wants him to be identified with Christ. He believe on or believe into. It's a unique privilege to be in Christ Jesus. That's believing on the Son. It includes believing on the Son. It includes such things as persuasion, determination, anticipation, aggressiveness. All that's including believing on the Son. And what about the person who believes on the Son, or in the Son, or into the Son? What about him? What about him? Well, he has everlasting life.
Yeah.
Now, John mentions this phrase 3 times, has everlasting life. In all 3 cases, it's all hinged to believing on Christ. All 3 cases. Jesus also said, whoso eats my flesh and drinks my blood hath eternal life, and I'll raise him up at the last day. Elsewhere, we know that having eternal life does not mean we have the whole of it at this time. For eternal life is also said to be inherited. Shall inherit. See, so you have it, but you inherit it. That's because you have the first fruits of it. You do have eternal life, but you don't have the whole of it. You've come into Canaan, but you're just a Jericho. Don't have it all. You'll inherit it in the world to come. This is the new creation. The new creation is having eternal life. That's what it is. It spells it out to you. There's a part of you that is eternal.
Yes.
From God's definition of eternal. It's a new creation. It's embodied in newness of life. That's the everlasting life or the eternal life. That newness of life, that's what that is. Mm-hmm. That's eternal life. And it's in its beginning stages, you might say. The new man, that's what that is. That's eternal,
yes.
Eternal life. Now it's realizing the person of Christ who dwells in our heart by faith. Mm-hmm. Now John said he wrote about Christ. He said he referring to Christ, mm-hmm. 1 John 1, 2, he says he is that eternal life.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So you have as much eternal life as you have with Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus is, quote, that eternal life. That's what John said. That's what he is. So we have, he that believes in him has eternal life, but he doesn't have the whole of it. But what he has is sufficient to make it through the world unscathed.
Amen.
What about the person that doesn't believe on the Son? What about him? Now notice a different way it's stated. Believeth not the Son, rather than believeth not on the Son. It's stated a little bit different. The other version says, does not believe the Son. American Standard Version says, obeys not the Son. New American Standard, does not obey the Son. New King James Version, rejects the Son. New Revised Standard Version, disobeys the Son. Basic Bible English, does not have faith in the Son. Contemporary English Bible doesn't believe in the Son. Holman Bible refuses to believe the Son. Darby's not subject to the Son. Living Bible don't believe and obey. Williams Bible refuses to trust in. Apostolic Bible resisting the Son. Message Bible, the one disobeying the Son, avoids and distrusts the Son. And the Amplified Bible says, disobeys, is unbelieving toward, refuses to trust in, disregards, is not obedient, not subject to. The word does mean disobey. Because a person who doesn't believe has, by the virtue of not believing, they have disobeyed.
Yeah.
Now, let me give you the lexical meaning of the word. It's not the word pistuo for faith or believing. It's a different word. It has the following meaning: not to allow oneself to be persuaded, throws up a barrier, not to comply with, to refuse or withhold belief, disobey, be disobedient, unwillingness or refusal to comply with the demands of some authority, disobey, disobedience. That's what not believing on the Son is. Now you may be tolerant of people that don't believe on the Son, but God is not.
That's right. Amen.
And Jesus is going to make that clear.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
The person who says, not now, but later, they're like Agrippa or Felix.
Uh-huh.
But they are. See, God didn't. This is interpreted by heaven as disobeyed.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
When you hear the gospel, the command is believe it.
Mm-hmm.
Every person who doesn't flee to Christ for refuge, tables a suggestion, they've disobeyed. That's what they've done. Refusal to receive him in the capacity of Lord and Savior. You know, they would probably accept Christ if it wasn't this Lord thing. Or you hear people say, I've heard this the better part of my life. I've heard people say, you've received him as Savior, now make him your Lord. I don't know who cooked that up, but we definitely need to get them out of circulation, whoever did. Because that isn't the way it is. Always Lord and Savior. It's never Savior and Lord.
Yeah.
And not believing is rejecting this Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Someone might receive a Christ that solved their problem, or maybe they were quite willing to receive a Christ that maybe helped them get over drugs or alcohol, or maybe they receive a Christ who's able to make their marriage more workable. But they're not willing to throw the weight of their soul upon Jesus, and not to do that is disobedience. It's in its essence is disobedience. It's a negative reaction.
Mm-hmm. Because he is Lord.
That's right.
Whether he's their Savior or not, he is their Lord.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
Now, what does he say? He that believes not the Son shall not see life.
Yeah.
Now, what does that mean? Now, I'm assuming that in its most precise definition, Christ is the life. He said, I am the life. If that's true, not see life means God will not let that person see Christ.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
He'll blind them
yes.
to the Christ.
That's right.
You may shout loud and long to him about he's the answer and blah, blah. But God will not let a person who refuses to be under the governorship of Jesus. He will not let that person see Christ.
Yeah. Yeah, amen.
He'll be hidden from him.
Yes.
Why? Because that would compound his situation, make it all the worse. He shall not experience life. Some of the versions shall not see life. Some of the other versions say, never see heaven. That's a Living Bible. See, that's an interpretation. That's not... won't experience life, not enter into life. All other versions read just what it says, see life. The vast majority of the 48 versions I have, 40 say not see life. Not see as in perceive.
Yeah.
You can't go to Jesus if you can't see him.
Yeah. Amen.
That ought to be plain to everybody. If you can't see Jesus, you're not going to run to him. Then what about this person that has disobeyed, that they haven't obeyed the gospel? The wrath of God, like a cloud, is traveling with him every place he goes.
Yes, amen.
The wrath of God, this is how much God thinks of Jesus now, that whoever doesn't receive his son, the wrath of God is right on top of them. At any moment, they could go to hell at any moment. It's just like that. If it's somebody you know and you're concerned about them, you just thank God they haven't passed away yet, Lord. Yeah. Give them grace. Bring them to repentance. Convict them of sin. Pray strong because you already know. Jesus, this is Jesus' words.
That's right.
Whoever doesn't believe on him, doesn't accept him as God has proclaimed him, God's angry with that person. The wrath of God has to do with God's anger. It doesn't have to do with God's mercy or love or grace, not wrath. No, wrath doesn't have anything to do with those things.
Yeah.
The wrath of God. Yeah. That's the worst wrath there is. There's no worse wrath than the wrath of God.
Yes.
It's the worst anger there is. It's on, that's what it says. It abides.
Yes.
Stays on them. Yeah. When they go to bed, wrath of God's on them.
Yeah.
When they wake up, wrath of God's on them. Mm. When they go to work, wrath of God's on them. Even if they go to church, the wrath of God's on them.
Yeah.
So you got to believe it. It's a serious stuff.
Amen.
Not divine favor. Don't be telling someone that disobeys Jesus, God loves you, God's going to help you. Don't beat them because that's not true.
Yeah. That's right.
Tell them now. I'm going to tell you this because I care about you. I'm not glad about this situation, but if you don't get over this not believing on the Son, God's anger is settled on you. Right now, while we're talking so-and-so, the wrath of God's on top of you.
Yeah.
Doesn't have to be.
Uh-huh.
There's a gospel that tells you how to get out from underneath this cloud. You can do it. And reason with people and plead with them on that basis. Maybe they'll say like Agrippa, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian, but that wasn't enough.
Yeah.
Paul said, oh, I would you were altogether persuaded.
Yeah.
Oh, I would you were altogether persuaded.
Yes.
The wrath of God. Instead of, this particularly applies to the person who's been subjected to the gospel. Now, God nowhere says, everybody who doesn't believe on Christ is going to hell. Although that's pretty close to the truth, but that isn't how it's said. It's whoever doesn't believe. Very careful, because when people haven't heard the gospel, that's something that we don't have any authority to operate in that realm. That's God has to do with that, see? But this particularly has to do with those that have heard the gospel. And if a person's convinced of this, they'll be about doing as much as they can.
Yes.
Letting the gospel be made known by word and by life.
Yes, amen.
Our life should be like a walking New Testament,
yes,
so to speak. Mm-hmm. A good news. Look at here. Look at here what the Lord's done for me. Mm-hmm. Just watch how I've been reacting to some of the hard things I've been experiencing. Take a look at how I'm reacting. This wasn't natural. Mm-hmm. I had to get strength from heaven to react like this. Otherwise, I'm just like you and everybody else. But I received strength to do this and be a talking testimonial, mm-hmm, of what it's like to not be under the wrath of God. Uh-huh. For the wrath of God not to be. See, God's not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation, which is in Christ Jesus. So the wrath of God, don't threaten believers.
Uh-huh.
You don't threaten believers.
Yeah.
You tell them you've not been appointed to wrath. Now live accordingly.
Yes, amen.
So particularly, see, everybody is condemned out of Christ. This is true. Judgment came unto condemnation. Romans 5, 16 and 18 say that very clearly. So condemnation in general is over the race, but he's not speaking in general.
That's right.
It's he that.
That's right.
See, it's a different situation here. And he that has heard the message,
yes,
and has spurned it.
Uh-huh.
He's in bad shape. You need to fear and tremble for people like that.
Mm-hmm.
And labor, do your best. Save them with fear. That's fear in you. Because
uh-huh,
those kind of people can contaminate you.
Mm-hmm.
They can, if you're not careful, they'll dull your own,
yes,
they'll dull your own commitment to the Lord Jesus. You'll think you got more power than you got.
Yeah, that's right.
See? But labor for them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, those are the words of Jesus, and of course makes them preeminent.
Yeah, I can see when you're talking to people and ministering to people, you can make a quick judgment and say, well, they've rejected it. But see, you don't know.
Don't
the
know.
Holy Spirit may be dealing with them. He may be persuading them, but see, the Holy Spirit can do a work. But. I can see here if a person has rejected it. The Holy Spirit knows that, but mm-hmm, I mean I can think I see it, but we're not called to make those kind of
no.
determinations. We're called to minister the gospel and to preach to people,
yeah,
and some you can make a difference.
Yeah, see, the person who does reject, they know they've rejected it, and that's where you got to transfer the responsibility.
Yeah, right.
We're not responsible for determining who or who
that's
this
right.
is or isn't.
Uh-huh.
But the person who is, God says enough,
yes,
they got to determine it. If you say, I don't want that,
uh-huh, yeah,
God says, and I don't want you.
Yes, that's right.
It's that personal now.
Uh-huh. Yes.
But that's you got to give a person enough information they can think properly
uh-huh.
about the situation. Yeah.
Yeah, a couple of comments. I want to go back a little further. When you were talking about he that believeth on the Son,
mm-hmm,
when the Scripture calls Jesus the Son, it's basically saying that Jesus has a unique relationship with God the Father.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But that also implies that he can bring us
yeah.
in.
Amen.
He can bring us uh-huh. into that fellowship. And frankly, he's the only one who can. That's
yeah,
the implication.
Yeah.
Amen.
So people like to argue, is Jesus the only way? Well, is there any other son?
That's right.
Yeah,
see,
no.
he is the Son of God. Now, he can make us sons of God.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But he's the only one that can confer that kind of status.
Amen.
And bring uh-huh. us in. And then a second thought, that the wrath of God abiding. You know, this whole thing, again, to go back to that earlier discussion about the love of God, we really don't, there's really no debate about this. Biblically,
mm-hmm.
God so loved the world that he gave
yeah.
us. The love of God has been offered
yeah.
to the world. This
That's
is
right.
not, this is not, this is very clear in
yes.
Scripture.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you think God is going to do with people who reject
That's right.
his love?
Amen.
Now, that's what this verse
that's it.
Is commenting on.
That's
what
it.
If God offers you his love
yeah.
in the form of, not just as like he wrote you a letter,
uh-huh.
but he sent his son.
Yeah.
Yeah.
and you reject that son, what do you think is going to be the result?
That's right.
Of that kind of rejection.
That's the context. The context is that this has been made known.
That's right.
The Hottentot over there in some foreign country has never heard the gospel. This isn't talking about. Uh-huh. This is not talking about them. Now they may be condemned, but that they may not too.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's not who this is talking about. Mm-hmm. This is for sure talking about all church people. This is for sure talking about them. So you find church people that are disobedient, then this applies to them.
I think it's talking about, you could say, all Americans. They've heard about Christ. Too. Like, who hasn't heard of Jesus?
Yeah. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Father Gibbons?
Yes,
to be. I was considering this evening when you said, don't be walking where Jesus doesn't approve of. We can see an example of this in the beginning. Just with Adam and Eve, when they began to walk in a way, so to speak, that was not approved by God, and ultimately that led to the fall of man. And so we see that's very serious. God takes that seriously. But I was considering that if we are blessed because God gave us Jesus Christ, who is the forerunner, who has gone before us and is now leading us. So we know what God approves of. And in knowing God more and reading in His Word, you get to know what God does approve of. And then considering when you said that God is pleased with everything Jesus does because it is right. When you're close to Jesus, then you know that God can be pleased with you and is approved of where you're walking.
That's
because
right.
You're walking with Christ. If you're far away from Christ, then you're not walking with
Him. That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, He sanctifies us. We don't sanctify Him.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Sister Ada.
The other side that you touched on, the other side of being unbelieving and having the wrath of God abide on us, which is our state without Christ. Now in Christ, the favor of God is upon us in every good work and in every will, Him doing His good will within us.
Amen. Yeah, eventually, I think probably very few people at the beginning see the scope of salvation, but eventually you grow, and eventually you can see that everything you need is resident in Christ, and Christ is disposed to give it to those that trust in Him.
Yes.
All right. Amen. Well, have Sister Barb come forward.